you respect him because he shoots scenes of love as if they were scenes of murder. We respect him because he shoots scenes of murder like a scenes of love.
Alfred Hitchcock is synonymous with vintage cinema. I mean, Alfred Hitchcock virtually is vintage cinema. His journey began in the fond old days of cinema. Old Hollywood, noir, black and white, and the era just beyond. This is an era remembered for a certain grace, elegance, even naivete. But Hitchcock's ideas and techniques far transcend that era, both chronologically and in terms of technical innovation and influence. When black and white transcended to Technicolor, Hitchcock was one of the auteurs that led the way and excelled within these new conventions. Furthermore, his 6 decades of work illustrate enormous staying power, even if a handful of his later films received more modest reviews. Indeed, his influence on subsequent generations, not least the French New Wave and American movie brats of the 1970s, have cemented a sometimes overwhelming notion that to stare into the cinematic soul of Hitch is to stare into the soul of cinema itself. Alfred Hitchcock's influence within successive generations of his own profession is immense. His brooding silhouette lingers menacingly over all those who casually enter the medium. The primary source of Hitchcock's influence lies in his particular blend of self-consciousness and popular storytelling. Some directors have developed Hitchcock's complex evocation of innocence and redemption. Others have chosen to amplify his representation of the darker side of human nature. Still, others draw upon the articulateness of Hitchcock's style, or upon the way he sometimes turns the experience of film viewing into a game or puzzle. These differing interpretations can be loosely gathered into 2 broad collectives. Hitchcockian influence upon European and American cinematic culture. European cinema. Of immense contemporary importance was the canonization of Hitchcock as the film director as creative artist by young French critics and filmmakers of the period, François Truffaut, Claude Chabrol, Eric Rohmer and Jean-Luc Godard, all of whom wrote on the director extensively. Hitchcock was not simply one of the American directors valorized by French filmmakers of the 1950s, he was the American filmmaker valorized by them. Hitchcock's films become a model for what we now call classic European cinema. Some of the most important European Hitchcockians have inhabited popular genres and idioms. From Roman Polanski to Paul Verhoeven, Dario Argento and Pedro Almodovar, while the films of the Hitchcockian David Lynch are genre-based, they bear many of the characteristics of modernist European cinema. In the case of all 5 of these directors, their impulse in a post-60s environment is to give expression to a distinctly Hitchcockian world vision. American cinema. Although Hitchcock only made 2 true horror films, Psycho and The Birds, both films had a decisive influence on the mainstream emergence of the horror genre, from the shadows of the B-movie and exploitation film. Homages to famous Hitchcock films are peppered throughout many of Steven Spielberg's greatest hits, such as the dolly zoom effect in Jaws that was originally in Vertigo. It is also not hard to see the comparisons between the crop duster scene in North by Northwest and the boulder scene in Raiders of the Lost Ark. However, the similarities between Spielberg and Hitchcock are perhaps most apparent if we look at Jurassic Park as a potential reworking of The Birds. Jurassic Park emphasizes avian kinship of the dinosaurs, and like Hitchcock, Spielberg is supremely invested in giving agency to his monstrous beings. In both films, confrontation with the monster catalyzes a transformation in the family, and The Birds takes on attributes of a threatening femininity. Hitchcock's birds are the proverbial harpies, while in Jurassic Park, the dinosaurs represent a fecund, self-reproducing nature. Even the idea of Jurassic Park as a dinosaur prison faintly echoes Hitchcock's representation of the caged lovebirds. Also related to this, in both films, the terms of entrapment between humans and creatures are reversed. Hitchcock's mastery of the psychological thriller and horror genres, in which the narration flaunts its control of the spectator's access to the whereabouts of the villain or monster, is evident in John Carpenter's psycho-influenced horror film, Halloween, which develops the narration by leaving it uncertain whether the camera's point of view does or does not conceal from the spectator the presence of the killer. Martin Scorsese's psychological melodramas also explicitly reference the work of Hitchcock. In Cape Fear, husband and wife, played by Nick Nolte and Jessica Lange, make love to Bernard Herrmann's tremulous violins, washed with alternating red and violet warning colours which are caused by the fireworks, borrowing from the aesthetic of Vertigo and Marnie. However, it is Brian De Palma who has appropriated the Hitchcockian position in a more literal-minded way than any other director. He adapts Hitchcock's plots willy-nilly. Obsession remakes Vertigo, Dress to Kill reworks Psycho, and so on. He's also a learned student of Hitchcock's style, as black comedy pervades his work and his films are structured around patterns of doubling, often quite literally as in Sisters and Raising Cain. He utilizes unreliable narration that is flawed in his disguised dream sequences, such as the opening and closing of Dress to Kill. He obsessively quotes scenes from Hitchcock's works, especially the shower scene from Psycho, which is reworked in Phantom of the Paradise, Carrie, and Blowout, not to mention the bathroom scenes in Scarface. Characteristically, De Palma incorporates an element of Hitchcock's style and intensifies it in ways that can seem gratuitously excessive. Are entertaining. Hitchcock's technical influence on the industry looms as large today as it has for the past 8 decades. But precisely which techniques did Hitchcock pioneer or help redefine? And how is it best to understand them and their significance to the art? The scene reveal shot. Hitchcock was known as the master of suspense, but as it happens, he was also the master of immersing you into the world of the film and demanding your attention from the very first frame. Whether it be the devastating introductory pan of rope, the stylistic train boarding of Strangers on a Train, or the iconic Bernard Herrmann accompanied opening to Psycho. Hitchcock's relishing of a film's opening moments have been often imitated, but rarely bettered. Visual trickery. Hitchcock went to outrageous lengths to achieve a shot, often defining himself as a maverick pioneer in the process. He used an enormous novelty phone and a fake finger just to achieve the famous dialing shot at Dial M for Murder, and the remarkable Vertigo zoom has been aped by the likes of Spielberg and Scorsese. Intense Technicolor. Though his career easily predates Technicolor, as soon as colour first began to be added to the moving picture, Hitch was at the forefront of the movement to best utilise this powerful new narrative tool. The use of red alone in films like Vertigo and Marnie makes for hypnotic viewing, and easily emphasises the heightened emotional tension of the scenes in which they feature. Narrated close-ups. Hitchcock's method for directing close-ups, particularly those of his female leads, was as fascinating as it was unique. With a megaphone firmly in hand, Hitchcock would actually narrate to the actors as the cameras were rolling, giving them extensive motivation live from the director's mouth. This technique is well emphasized by Anthony Hopkins' remarkable portrayal in this clip.
You think they can't tell, but they can. They know. You can feel that noose tighten around that breakable little neck. I mean, you could return the money secretly, but what would that prove? It's too late. Poor Marion Crane, always so tight, so respectable, so prim and so proper, perfect, untouchable, unsullied Miss Crane, Daddy's perfect little angel. And now they all know those dirty little secrets you've been hiding so long. Messy, sticky little lunchtime trysts with that oh-so-handsome failure, Mr. Samuel Loomis. They'll smirk, they'll gossip, and they'll whisper. Even your boss, straight-laced, hatchet-faced Mr. George Lowry, why, even he can smell the rancid, pungent scent of sex all over you.
It's fascinating to look back at Janet Leigh's seductive grin, knowing that she was actually reacting to Alfred Hitchcock's demanding voice in real time. Hyper-cinematic scenes and moments. From a conclusion atop Mount Rushmore to the bleak gothic romance of Manderley, Hitchcock was always a filmmaker's filmmaker. He never spared expense, effort, or imagination in the realization of a shot or sequence. Psycho alone delivers over a dozen era-defining shots that linger in the subconscious long after the film has ended. And don't even get us started about the ludicrously suggestive closing shots of North by Northwest. Saucy.
Some moments of scenes were considered too awful to show.
In those days.
How do you feel about that?
Well, there's more permissiveness today, but don't forget that's 10 years ago. Things were quite different then.
You think if they showed Psycho now, they would be able to show every scene that you shot?
Oh, I think so, without a question, sure.
Really? I doubt that, because they were rather worried that we were showing anything tonight from that.
Well, there's a different approach for television than there is for movies.
Oh, yes, I meant on television. That on television.
Television, the same conditions apply today.
Still, yeah, I see. I didn't make
But
that
I'm surprised, clear. Really, that in English television, when I was over there, they allow a certain amount of nudity on English television.
Complete nudity on English television.
Yes, considering the weather over there, I'm surprised.
In trying to position Hitchcock with respect to his time, one is drawn in two distinct directions. He was at once a latter-day eminent Victorian, the stereotype of bourgeois caution and conventionality that contemporary modernists satirized and relegated to the dust heap of culture. But by the same token, in choosing film, the medium that had superseded the novel in line with historical progression, Hitchcock was in fact more modern than those same critics, who remained attached to the written word. As we have seen, countless filmmakers have channeled Hitchcock's dark vision through their lenses. But as gloomy and frightening as many of his films were, Hitchcock was usually relaxed and cheerful while filming, especially when the cameras were turned towards him. And the director, renowned above all as the master of suspense, never lost his sense of humor as he aged. Alfred Hitchcock was an innovator in the field of filmmaking, and he lives on in the work of those influenced by his masterpieces. His films and notoriety are definitely not for the birds. Feel free to pop open some champagne and raise your glasses and your cell phones as you dial L for legend.
Independent Pictures!